So, hello and welcome everybody to another reading of Babylon Mystery Religion with Juggler 66 from Hour of the Truth. This is the final chapter of the book, chapter 21, and it's called The Mystery of the Mixture. So, of course, you would expect normally this to be the last video of the book, but this is not so because I already announced that I will make a video about the weak reputation of the book that Ralph Woodrow did afterwards, and that comes after this. But first, we're going to do now a reading of chapter 21, as I said, called The Mystery of the Mixture. It's a little bit of a summary of everything in that book that we have seen so far, which was quite a lot. And sure, for a lot of people who have not studied this issue and were not aware of this sun worship. You know, I've called it a lot sun worship every time it was written, pagan worship in the book, but that is also because they actually worship the sun, the S-U-N, meaning they worship the creation and not the creator. That's what Satan stands for, because he was himself a created being and wants to be worshipped. So you first have to worship the creation before you can accept Satan. That's exactly his goal. But okay, let's continue the reading now. We have seen by scores of examples throughout the book, that a mixture of sun worship and Christianity produced the Roman Catholic Church. A mixture, it is said in this book. And you can also call that compromise. You know, that's the problem. Whether you have white or you have black, or, as it is taught today, you have a lot of gray. Like I said in one of the chapters before, 50 Shades of Gray, you know, that famous book. I haven't read it, but there are a lot of people out there who read that. But that means taking away that there are two absolutes. And this world does not teach absolutism anymore. Everything is relative. And to a Bible-believing Christian, there are absolutes. There is an absolute truth, and there is an absolute lie, and there is nothing in between. And this is what separates the view of a Bible-believing Christian from all the other people in the world, who love to compromise and who want to see a lot of gray, want to see a lot of truth mixed with lie, so that it is comfortable for them. The pagan S-U-N sun worshippers worshipped and prayed to a mother goddess, so the fallen church adopted mother worship under the name of Mary. The sun worshippers had gods and goddesses associated with various days, occupations, and events in life. Well, there is another falling away. They had gods and goddesses. The Bible speaks of only one God. There is only one and no other. This system was adopted and the gods were called saints. The sun worshippers used statues or idols of their pagan deities in their worship, so the fallen church did also, simply calling them by different names. From ancient times, crosses in various forms were regarded in superstitious ways. Some of these ideas were adopted and associated with the cross of Christ. The cross was an image was outwardly honored, but the true finished sacrifice of the cross became obscured by the rituals of the Mass with its transubstantiation, mystery, drama, and prayers for the dead. You remember when I was reading that chapter of the transubstantiation, hoc est corpus meum, in the little poem that I was reading there. It's not hoc est corpus meus, as I said, it is hoc est corpus meum. Transferring this little round wafer thing into the full body, divinity, soul, blood, and body of Jesus Christ. Transubstantiation. A mystery, drama, and prayers for the dead. We Christians don't pray for the dead. we pray to our living God, because our God is the God of the living and not the God of the dead. That is Satan. Repetitious prayers, rosaries, and relics were all adopted from SUN pagan sun worship and given a surface appearance of Christianity. A surface appearance, exactly. When you study Roman Catholicism, you can see that on the surface it is Christianity, but the moment that you dig into it, you can see that it only veiled itself with the name of Christianity and has nothing to do with the Christianity preached by our Lord Jesus Christ. On the surface, it appears as Christianity. The sun worship office and title of Pontifex Maximus was applied to the Bishop of Rome. He became known as the Pope, the Father of Fathers, even though Jesus said to call no man Father. In literally hundreds of ways, sun worship rites were merged into Christianity at Rome. Catholic scholars recognized that their church developed from such a mixture. But from their point of view, these things were triumphs for Christianity because the church was able to Christianize SUN sun-worshipping pagan practices. The Catholic Encyclopedia, once again, makes these statements. Quote, "We need not shrink from admitting that candles like incense and lustre water were commonly employed in pagan worship and in the rites paid to the dead. But the Church, from a very early period, took them into their service, just as she adopted many other things, like music, lights, perfumes, ablutions, floral decorations, canopies, fans, screens, bells, vestments, etc., which were not identified with any idolatrous cult in particular. They were common to almost all cults." Unquote. Yeah, the biggest cult in the world is Roman Catholicism. And all the things that I've just listed here were common in almost all cults. And all these cults, not only the Roman Catholic Church, but all other so-called quote-unquote religions, man-made belief systems, derive from Babylon. And the Bible is very clear about this and tells us about it. And this book told us about it. And the book which this one is based on, for a big part, Alexander Hislop's The Two Babylons, tells us in even much more detail how all religion, which is a man-made belief system, comes out of Babylon. And God told us about this. So just go to the real source, the Bible, and you see where all the other things derive from. And the Roman Catholic Church and their own encyclopedia state that over and over again. Now, continues here. Water, oil, light, incense, singing, procession, prostration, decoration of altars, vestments of priests are naturally at the service of universal religious instinct. Even pagan feasts may be baptized. Certainly our processions of 25th of April are the Robigalia. The Rogation days may replace the Ambarualia. The date of Christmas Day may be due to the same instinct which placed on December 25th the Natalis Invicti of the solar cult. Unquote. The use of statues and customs such as bowing before an image, which is forbidden in the second commandment, are explained in Catholic theology as having developed from the older emperor worship. Quote, "The etiquette of the Byzantine court gradually evolved elaborate forms of respect, not only for the person of Caesar, but even for his statues and symbols." Philostorgius says that in the 4th century the Christian Roman citizens in the East offered gifts, incense, even prayers to the statues of the emperor. It would be natural that people who bowed to, kissed, incensed, and the imperial eagles and images of Caesar, with no suspicion of anything like idolatry, should give the same signs to the cross, the images of Christ and the altar. The first Christians were accustomed to see statues of emperors, of pagan gods and heroes, as well as sun sun worship wall paintings. So they made paintings of their religion and, as soon as they could afford them, statues of their lord and of their heroes." Unquote. It should be noticed that no claim for any scriptural command is even suggested for these things. It is clearly stated that these customs developed from pagan sun sun worship. Sometimes various wall paintings of the early centuries, such as those in the Roman catacombs that you can still see today, are referred to as though they represented the beliefs of the original Christians. We do not believe this is the case, for there is clear evidence of a mixture. While some of these paintings included scenes of Christ feeding the multitudes with the loaves and fishes, Jonah and the whale, or the sacrifice of Isaac, other paintings were unmistakably sun sun worship portrayals. Some believe this mixture was a disguise to avoid persecution. Nevertheless, it cannot be denied that the roots of mixture were present, says the Catholic Encyclopedia once again. Quote, "The good shepherd carrying the sheep on his shoulders occurs frequently, and this preference may well be due to its resemblance to the sun sun worship figures of Hermes, Cryophorus and Aristaeus, which at this period were much in vogue. Even the fable of Orpheus was borrowed pictorially and referred to Christ. Similarly, the story of Eros and Psyche was revived and Christianized, serving to remind the believers of the resurrection of the body. The group of the 12 apostles probably attracted the less attention because the twelve Dei Majoris, means the major gods, were often also grouped together. Again, the figure of the Orens, the woman with the arms uplifted in prayer, was quite familiar to classical antiquity. Similarly, the fish symbol, representing Christ, the anchor of hope, the palm of victory, were all sufficiently familiar as emblems among pagans to excite no particular attention." Unquote. That was, again, the Catholic Encyclopedia. In the Old Testament, the apostasy into which the Israelites repeatedly fell was that of mixture. Usually, they did not totally reject the worship of the true God, but mixed heathen rites with it, mixing the holy with the profane. That is how the Bible calls it, and that is an abomination to our Lord. This was the case even when they worshipped the golden calf, as we can read in Exodus chapter 32. And I'm going to read to you the complete chapter between verses 1 and 30 to really make the point of that to be good and well understood. Exodus chapter 2 from the King James Version. Quote, "And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us out of the land of Egypt, we know not what is become of him. And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives and of your sons and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people brake off the golden earrings which were in their ears, and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hands, and fashioned it with a graving tool, after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made proclamation, and said, Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. And they rose up early on the morrow, and offered burnt offerings, and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink, and rose up to play. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it. and have sacrificed thereunto, and said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath may vex hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation. And Moses besought the Lord his God, and said, Lord, why doth thy wrath vex hot against thy people, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt, with great power and with a mighty hand? Wherefore should the Egyptians speak and say, For mischief did he bring them out, to slay them in the mountains, and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from thy fierce wrath, and repent of this evil against thy people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants, to whom thou swearest by thine own self, and saidst unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of will I give unto your seed, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do unto his people. And Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tables of testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides, on the one side and on the other were they written. And the tables were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God, graven upon the tables. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, There is a noise of war in the camp. And he said, It is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the calf, and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand, and brake them beneath the mount. And he took the calf which they had made, and burned it in the fire, and ground it to powder, and strawed it upon the water, and made the children of Israel drink of it. And Moses said unto Aaron, What did this people unto thee, that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them? And Aaron said, Let not the anger of my Lord wax hot. Thou knowest the people, that they are set on mischief. For they said unto me, Make us gods, which shall go before us. For this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him. And I said unto them, Whosoever hath any gold, let him break it off. So they gave it me, then I cast it into the fire, and there came out this calf. And when Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked unto their shame among their enemies, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp, and said, Who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. And he said unto them, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, Put every man his sword by his side, and go in and out from the gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. For Moses had said, Consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, even every man upon his son and upon his brother, that he may bestow upon you a blessing this day. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said unto the people, Ye have sinned a great sin, and now I will go up unto the mountain. My text ends here. I think I didn't copy the whole part of Exodus here. Let me check this right now. So verse 30. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said unto the people, Ye have sinned a great sin. And now I will go up unto the Lord. Preadventure I shall make an atonement for your sin. And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, Oh, this people have sinned a great sin, and have made them gods of gold. Yet know, if thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written. And the Lord said unto Moses, Whosoever hath sinned against me, him I will blot out of my book. Therefore now go, Lead the people unto the place of which I have spoken unto thee. Behold, mine angel shall go before thee. Nevertheless, in the day when I will visit their sin upon them. And the Lord plagued the people, because they made the calf which Aaron made." End quote from Exodus 32. Sorry, I forgot to copy a few sentences out of there, so that can happen sometimes in preparation when you look over that. But the point being is, as soon as they had the chance, they just left the slavery they were for 400 years in Egypt. And as soon as they had the chance, as soon as their quote-unquote leader, Moses, was gone, they fell apart. As soon as Jesus was taken up to heaven after his resurrection, also, very shortly after that, there came the falling away in the church, and the mixture, what we are talking about here in the church. The people always want some person to rely on, and today the Pope is perfectly playing that role and giving him the one that they can look up to. We have to realize that God is spirit, and the belief in God and the faith in God is spiritual, not carnal. Therefore, we have to leave this carnal thing and put on our spirituality. That happens normally when you are getting born again. And that is the difference between a born-again Christian and a lot of these so-called professed Christians out there. We know that our God is real, even though we cannot see him, we cannot touch him, we cannot smell him, but he is there. And the people in Israel at that time, who just came out of Egypt, only needed this little time that Moses went up to the hill to receive the law, and they fell away, and rather worshipped a golden calf. And if I didn't cover the golden calf in this book, because I don't know all the chapters by heart, you know, then just look it up in the two Babylons of Hyslop. There's the reason why it is a calf, or a bull, actually, that is then worshipped. Anyway, you know that this was even the case when they worshipped the golden calf in the Exodus, as I just read. And we all realize that such worship was false. It was heathenism and an abomination in the sight of God. Yet, and this is the point we would make, it was claimed that this was a feast unto the Lord, as we read in verse 5. A feast to God, or more correctly, Yahweh, as stands here, the true God is called I Am. I do not call God Jehovah, I do not call him Yahweh, I call him the God I Am, as he revealed his name in the Bible once. And that's the name that I address him to. But that's me. You can call him whatever you want, I call him the one true God I Am. They sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. They practiced rites in which they made themselves naked, as we read in verse 25, and perhaps similar to those which were carried out by naked Babylonian priests. During the 40 years in the wilderness, the Israelites carried the tabernacle of God. However, some of them were not content with this, so they added something. They made unto themselves a Babylonian tabernacle that was carried also. Quote, "But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Moloch and Kion, your images," as we can read in Amos 5 and the verses 25 through 27. Quote, "Have ye offered unto me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel? But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Moloch and your Kion, and your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves. Therefore will I cause you to go into captivity beyond Damascus, saith the Lord, whose name is the God of hosts." Unquote. And we also read about this in Acts chapter 7, verses 42 and 43. Quote, Then God turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets, O ye house of Israel, have ye offended to me, slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness? Yea, ye took up the tabernacle of Moloch, and the star of your god Remphan, figures which ye made to worship them, and I will carry you away beyond Babylon. Unquote. You know, this is Stephen speaking in Acts 7, verses 42 and 43, just before they stone him, before the Sadducees finally understood that they have slain Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah, who was announced not only but explicitly in Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. These were but other names for the Sun sun god Baal and the mother goddess Astarte, which is, as we have learned also, Ishtar, Easter. Because of this mixture, their songs of worship, sacrifices and offerings were rejected by God. At another period, the Israelites performed secret rites, built high places, used divination, caused their children to pass through the fire, and worshipped the Sun, sun, moon, and stars, as we can read in the book, second book of Kings, chapter 17, verses 7 through 18. Quote, For so it was that the children of Israel had sinned against the Lord their God, which had brought them up out of the land of Egypt from under the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and had feared other gods, and walked in the statutes of the heathen, whom the Lord cast out from before the children of Israel and of the kings of Israel which they had made. And the children of Israel did secretly those things that were not right against the Lord their God, and they built them high places in all their cities, from the tower of the watchman to the fenced city. And they set them up images and groves in every high hill and under every green tree. And there they burned incense in all the high places, as did the heathen, whom the Lord carried away before them, and wrought wicked things to provoke the Lord to anger. For they served idols whereof the Lord had said unto them, Ye shall not do this thing. Yet the Lord testified against Israel and against Judah by all the prophets and by all the seers, saying, Turn ye from your evil ways, and keep my commandments and my statutes, according to all the law which I commanded your fathers, and which I sent to you by my servants the prophets. Notwithstanding, they would not hear, but hardened their necks, like to the neck of their fathers, that did not believe in the Lord their God. And they rejected his statutes, and his covenant that he made with their fathers, and his testimonies which he testified against them. And they followed vanity, and became vain, and went after the heathen that were round about them, concerning whom the Lord had charged them, that they should not do like them. And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God, and made them molten images, even two calves, and made a grove, and worshipped all the host of heaven, and served Baal. And they caused their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire, and used divination and enchantments, and sold themselves to the evil in the sight of the Lord, to provoke him to anger. Therefore the Lord was very angry with Israel, and removed them out of his sight. There was none left but the tribe of Judah only. Unquote. As a result, they were driven from their land. The king of Assyria brought men from various nations, including Babylon, to inhabit the land from which the Israelites had been taken. These also practiced heathenistic rituals, and God sent lions among them, recognizing such as the judgment of God. They sent for a man of God to teach them how to fear the Lord. Quote, Howbeit, every nation made gods of their own. Unquote, as we read in the verses 29 through 31 in the second book of Kings, chapter 17. Quote, Howbeit, every nation made gods of their own, and put them in the houses of the high places which the Samaritans had made, every nation in their cities wherein they dwelt. And the men of Babylon made Succoth-Benoth, and the men of Cuth made Nergal, and the men of Hamath made Ashima. And the Evites made Nibhas and Tartak, and the Sepharvites burned their children in fire to Adrammelech and Anammelech, the gods of Sepharvaim. So, howbeit every nation made gods of their own, attempting to worship these gods and the Lord also, a mixture. Quote, so in this way they feared the Lord and made unto themselves of the lowest of them priests. They feared the Lord and served their own gods. That we can read in verse 32 of the same book. Mixture was also apparent in the days of judges, when a Levite priest who claimed to speak the word of the Lord served in quote-unquote house of gods and was called by the title Father, as we can read in the book of Judges, verses 5, 7 through 13. Quote, and there was a young man out of Bethlehem Judah, in the family of Judah, who was a Levite, and he sojourned there. And the man departed out of the city of Bethlehem Judah to sojourn where he could find a place. And he came to Mount Ephraim, to the house of Micah, as he sojourned. And Micah said unto him, whence comest thou? And he said unto him, I am a Levite from Bethlehem Judah, and I go to sojourn where I may find a place. And Micah said unto him, dwell with me, and be unto me a father and a priest, and I will give thee 10 shekels of silver by the year, and a suit of apparel, and thy victuals. So the Levite went in. And the Levite was content to dwell with the man, and the young man was unto him as one of his sons. And Micah consecrated the Levite, and the young man became his priest, and was in the house of Micah. Then said Micah, now know I that the Lord will do me good, seeing I have a Levite to my priest. Unquote. From the book of Judges. At the time of Ezekiel, an idol had been placed right at the entrance of the Jerusalem temple. Right at the entrance, priests offered incense to false gods, which were pictured upon the walls. This is the mixture. Women wept for Tammuz, and men worshipped the sun at dawn from the temple area, as we can read in Ezekiel chapter 8. Quote, and it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I sat in mine house, and the elders of Judah sat before me, that the hand of the Lord God fell there upon me. Then I beheld, and lo, a likeness as the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his loins even downward fire, and from his loins even upward as the appearance of brightness, as the color of amber. And he put forth the form of an hand, and took me by a lock of mine head, and the Spirit lifted me up between the earth and the heaven, and brought me in the visions of God to Jerusalem, to the door of the inner gate that looketh toward the north, where was the seat of the image of jealousy which provoketh to jealousy. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, according to the vision that I saw in the plain. Then said he unto me, Son of man, lift up thine eyes now from the way toward the north. So I lifted up mine eyes at the way toward the north, and behold, northward at the gate of the altar, this image of jealousy in the entry. He said furthermore unto me, Son of man, seest thou what they do? Even the great abominations that the house of Israel committeth here, that I should go far off from my sanctuary? But turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations. And he brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, behold, a hole in the wall. Then said he unto me, Son of man, dig now in the wall. And when I had digged in the wall, behold, a door. And he said unto me, go in, and behold the wicked abominations that they do there. So I went in, and saw, and behold every form of creeping things, and abominable beasts, and all the idols of the house of Israel, portrayed upon the wall round about. And there stood before them 70 men of the ancients of the house of Israel, and in the midst of them stood Jezaniah, the son of Shaphan, with every man his censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went up. Then said he unto me, Son of man, hast thou seen what the ancients of the house of Israel do in that dark, every man in the chamber of his imagery? For they say, The Lord seeth us not, the Lord hath forsaken the earth. He said also unto me, Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations that they do. Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Then said he unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs towards the temple of the Lord, and their faces toward the east, and they worshipped the sun toward the east. Then he said unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Is it a light thing to the house of Judah that they commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence, and have returned to provoke me to anger, and lo, they put the branch to their nose. Therefore will I also deal in fury, mine eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity. And though they cry in mine ears with a loud voice, yet will I not hear them. Unquote. Some even sacrificed their children, and, quote, when they had slain their children to their idols, God said, then they came the same day to my sanctuary. We read this in Ezekiel chapter 23, verses 38 and 39. Quote, Moreover, this they have done unto me. They have defiled my sanctuary in the same day, and have profaned my Sabbaths. For when they had slain their children to their idols, and they came the same day into my sanctuary to profane it, and lo, thus have they done in the midst of mine house. Unquote. Jeremiah's message was directed to people who claimed to worship the Lord, as we can read in Jeremiah chapter 7. And this is going to be a long quote again, but I think it is absolutely important to, in this last chapter, really cite a lot of the true Word of God, the Bible, to understand the mixture that men have always fallen to, even though they were taken right out of bondage of Egypt, and still they fell back into abomination and abomination. And it is only through the Word of God that we learn of this, and we can see that history repeats itself, and we can put this moment where we stand today in our lives here into the right perspective. So we really have to understand the Word of God. Therefore, now I'm going to read to you Jeremiah chapter 7. Quote, The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, Stand in the gate of the Lord's house, and proclaim there is word, and say, Hear the word of the Lord, and all ye of Judah that enter at these gates to worship the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, Amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Trust ye not in lying words, saying, The temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. For if ye thoroughly amend your ways and your doings, if ye truly execute judgment between a man and his neighbor, if ye oppress not the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow, and shed not innocent blood in this place, neither walk after other gods to your hurt, then will I cause you to dwell in this place, in the land that I gave to your fathers, for ever and ever. Behold, ye trust in lying words that cannot profit. will ye steal, murder, and commit adultery, and swear falsely, and burn incense unto Baal, and walk after other gods whom ye know not? And come stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations? Is this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your eyes? Behold, even I have seen it, saith the Lord. But go ye now unto my place, which was in Shiloh, where I set my name at the first, and see what I did to it for the wickedness of my people Israel. And now, because you have done all these works, saith the Lord, and I spake unto you, rising up early and speaking, but ye heard not, and I called you, but ye answered not. Therefore will I do unto this house which is called by my name, wherein ye trust, and unto the place which I gave to you and to your fathers, as I have done to Shiloh. And I will cast you out of my sight, as I have cast out all your brethren, even the whole seed of Ephraim. Therefore pray not thou for this people, neither lift up cry nor prayer for them, neither make intercession to me, for I will not hear thee. Seest thou not what they do in the cities of Judah and the streets of Jerusalem? The children gather wood, the fathers kindle the fire, and the women knead their dough to make cakes to the Queen of Heaven, Semiramis, and to pour out drink offerings unto other gods, that they may provoke me to anger. Do they provoke me to anger? Saith the Lord, do they not provoke themselves to the confusion of their own faces? Therefore thus saith the Lord God, behold, mine anger and my fury shall be poured out upon this place, upon man and upon beasts and upon the trees of the field and upon the fruit of the ground, and it shall burn and shall not be quenched. Thus saith the Lord of the host, the God of Israel, put your burnt offerings unto your sacrifices and eat flesh. For I speak not unto your fathers, nor commanded them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings or sacrifices. But this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people, and walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well unto you. But they hearkened not, nor inclined their ear, but walked in the counsels and the imagination of their evil heart, and went backward and not forward. Since the day that your fathers came forth out of the land of Egypt unto this day, I have even sent unto you all my servants the prophets, daily rising up early, sending them. Yet they hearkened not unto me, nor inclined their ear, but hearkened their neck. They did worse than their fathers. Therefore thou shalt speak all these words unto them, but they will not hearken to thee. Thou shalt also call unto them, but they will not answer thee. But thou shalt say unto them, this is a nation that obeyeth not the voice of the Lord their God, nor receiveth correction. Truth is perished, and is cut off from their mouth. Cut off thine hair, O Jerusalem, and cast it away, and take up a lamentation on high places, for the Lord hath rejected and forsaken the generation of his wrath. For the children of Judah have done evil in my sight, saith the Lord. They have set their abominations in the house which is called by my name, to pollute it. And they have built the high places of Tophet, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my heart. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall be no more, be called Tophet, for the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter, for they shall bury in Tophet till there be no place. And the carcasses of this people shall be meat for the fowls of the heaven, and for the beasts of the earth, and none shall fray them away. Then will I cause to cease from the cities of Judah, and from the streets of Jerusalem, the voice of mirth, and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, and the voice of the bride, for the land shall be desolate." Unquote. I really thought it was necessary to read the whole chapter of Jeremiah 7. But now I'll continue for a moment in the book. We should remember that Satan does not appear as a monster with horns, a long tail, and a pitchfork, even though he is pictured that way sometimes, but that's not the way he appears. Instead, he appears as an angel of light, as we can read in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 13 through 14. Quote, "For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works." Unquote. As Jesus warned about wolves in sheep's clothing, as we can read in Matthew chapter 7, verses 14 through 16. Quote, "Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns, or figs of thistles?" Unquote. So in numerous instances, the pagan worship that was disguised in the outer garments of Christianity became a mixture, became a compromise, mixing the holy with the profane over and over again, and thereby destroying the holiness. So, in numerous instances, the pagan worship that was disguised in the outer garments of Christianity became a mixture that has deceived millions. Well, you can even say billions of people in the way of the world. It was like removing the warning label from a bottle of poison and substituting a peppermint candy label in its place. The contents are deadly, just the same. Remember the wonderful poem in chapter 17 on the transubstantiation? Hoc est corpus meum? I put arsenic in the batter, but for you changed it, it doesn't matter, right? And this happens daily, that the label of warning is taken from the bottle of the poison that we all drink of, and people even like it. When you tell people today, do not drink Coca-Cola Light because it's poisonous to you, I got a lot of friends who say, I don't care and I drink 2 or 3 liters every day. I just don't care. They would probably even drink rat poisoning. That is how ignorant some people, I'm sorry I have to say, really are. No matter how much we dress it up on the outside, sun worship is deadly. True worship must be in spirit and in truth, as we read in chapter 4 of John, verse 24. Quote, "God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, and not in pagan sun-worshipping error." Now, considering these numerous biblical examples, it's clear that God is not pleased with worship that is a mixture. As Samuel preached, quote, "If ye do return unto the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth, the sun-worshipping mother worship, from among you, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord, and serve him only, and he will deliver you." Unquote. So we can read in 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 3. Because of the clever ways that pagan worship was mixed with Christianity, the Babylonian influence became hidden, a mystery Babylon. But as a detective gathers clues and facts in order to solve a mystery, so in this book we have presented many biblical and historical clues as evidence. Some of these clues may have seemed insignificant at first glance or when taken alone. But when the full picture is seen, they fit together and conclusively solve the mystery of Babylon, ancient and modern. Over the centuries, God has called his people out of the bondage of Babylon. Still today, his voice is saying, "Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins," as you can read in Revelation 18, chapter 4. It is a delicate task to write concerning religious subjects on which very fine and sincere people have strong differences. One wants to speak frankly enough to make a point, yet also to maintain a proper balance, so that in disagreeing he is not needlessly disagreeable. As with any book, certainly not excluding the Bible itself, it is inevitable that some misunderstanding or differences of opinion will result. Some may feel too much has been said, others not enough. Nevertheless, in the words of Pilate, quote, "What I have written," unquote. If the Roman Catholic Church, which claims to never change, is gradually turning from practices which are unscriptural, we can be glad for any progress along the path of truth. If this book has had any part in this trend, we can rejoice. Yeah, keep on dreaming, Ralph. The Roman Catholic Church never ever changes. So she is not gradually turning from practices which are unscriptural. She is luring people into unscriptural practices to come to her. We believe the true Christian goal is not religion based on mixture, but a return to the original, the simple, the powerful, and spiritual faith that was once delivered to the saints. No longer entangling ourselves in a maze of rituals and powerless traditions, we can find the simplicity that is in Christ and rejoice in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free from bondage, as we can read in 2 Corinthians 11:3 and Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Salvation is not dependent on a human priest. Salvation is not dependent on Mary, not on the saints or the Pope. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me," in John 14, verse 6. "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved," as you can read in Acts chapter 4, verse 12. Let us look to him who is the author and finisher of our faith, the apostle and high priest of our profession, the Lamb of God, the captain of our salvation, the bread from heaven, the water of life, the good shepherd, the prince of peace, the king of kings and lord of lords, Jesus Christ. So, this was so far the book, Babylon Mystery Religion, but I'm gonna add a few interesting comments and quotes from Catholic sources right here at the end to finish the reading of the book. You can read from The Faith of Our Fathers by James Cardinal Gibbons on page 72 on the question of the Sabbath changing times and dates. Quote, "A rule of faith or a competent guide to heaven must be able to instruct in all the truths necessary for salvation. Now the scriptures alone do not contain all the truths which a Christian is bound to believe, nor do they explicitly enjoin all the duties which he is obliged to practice. not to mention other examples, is not every Christian obliged to sanctify Sunday and to abstain at that day from unnecessary servile work? Is not the observance of his law among the most prominent of our sacred duties? But you may read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of Sunday. The scriptures enforce the religious observance of Saturday, the seventh day Sabbath, a day which we, the Roman Catholic Church, never sanctify. Unquote. And Dr. Cahill, Reverend Dr. Cahill, declared that, quote, he would rather the Catholic should read the worst books of immorality than the Protestant Bible, that forgery of God's word, that slander of Christ, unquote, as is recorded in the Roman Catholic Tablet of December 17, 1853, page 804. From the Faith of Our Fathers, page 69, and see also in the Faith of Millions, page 152, we read, quote, it was well for Luther that he did not come into the world until a century after the immortal invention of Gutenberg. You know, the book press, the movable type. 100 years earlier, his idea of directing 250 million men to read the Bible would have been received with shouts of laughter and would inevitably have caused his removal from the pulpit of Wittenberg to a hospital for the insane. Unquote. The decree set forth in the year 1229 AD by the Council of Valencia places Bible on the Index of Forbidden Books. The doctrine withholds, quote, it is forbidden for laymen, mean the common man, to read the Old and New Testaments. We forbid them most severely to have the above books in the popular vernacular. The lords of the districts shall carefully seek out the heretics in dwellings, hovels, and forests, and even their underground retreats shall be entirely wiped out, unquote. From the Council of Tolosanum, Pope Gregory the Ninth, in the year 1229 AD. Another interesting quote comes from the externals of the Catholic Church, her government, ceremonies, festivals, sacramentals, and devotions by John F. Sullivan, page 156, published in 1942. Quote, it is interesting to note how often our Church has availed herself of practices which were in common use among pagans. Thus it is true, in a certain sense, that some Catholic rites and ceremonies are a reproduction of those of pagan creeds. Unquote. And I would like to end with two quotes from the Bible. Psalm 55. Verses 16 through 23. Quote, as for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. Evening and morning and at noon will I pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice. He hath delivered my soul in peace from the battle that was against me, for there were many with me. God shall hear and afflict them, even he that abideth of old. Because they have no changes, therefore they fear not God. He hath put forth his hands against such as be at peace with him. He hath broken his covenant, the words of his mouth were smoother than butter, but war was in his heart. His words were softer than oil, yet were they drawn swords. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved, but thou, O God, shalt bring them down into the pit of destruction. Bloody and deceitful men shall not live out half their days, but I will trust in thee. Unquote. And I'm ending with Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Quote, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Unquote. These were the words of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And with this, I end the reading of Babylon Mystery Religion, the last very interesting chapter of The Mixture, almost a compilation of everything we read in this book. Bring it all together with a lot of Bible quotes and long, even chapter-long readings, but I thought that was very important and significant to do. So please, when you watch this video and when you watch the whole series, take it to your heart. You can download the book free as a PDF for the moment being on the internet. You can read it for yourselves, even without my comments in there. You can listen to it again, even with my comments in there. You can see if my comments were right or if they were wrong. If they were wrong, okay, then let me know. I do not think that I said anything wrong, but we'll see what you have to say about it. I very much enjoyed reading this book from Ralph Woodrow. I never read it entirely before I did the reading like I do here now in the audio recording, you know? Some things I read here for the very first time. I mean, I read every chapter before I recorded it, but before that I never read the whole book. I'm almost half through the two Babylons of Alexander Hislop that I read in German for the moment, and I can tell you that not anything in this book is not sustained by the work of Alexander Hislop. And why that is important, and not only Alexander Hislop, but also other sources, therefore I will make my finishing video of the subject Babylon Mystery Religion of Ralph Woodrow for the next time. But up to here, this was the last, the 21st chapter, The Mixture of Babylon Mystery Religion from Jörg, Jörgler 66, Hour of the Truth. God bless you and keep you in his ways on the narrow path that leads to salvation. God bless and keep you. Until next time. Jörgler 66, Hour of the Truth, sign off. Bye-bye.